Hello everybody, glad you could make it. My name is Kaylee Ellen and welcome to 10 plants with stable variegation. So variegated plants have always been a thing. I anticipate that they will probably continue to be a thing among plant collectors and hobbyists alike for some time. And there are so many different types of variegated plants out there, it's really hard to know which ones to spend your money on. Not only that, but a lot of houseplants can be pretty prone to reversion. So with that said, today I'm giving you a list of 10 plants with stable variegation, so you know where to kind of put your money if you're unsure. So to get a couple of things out of the way first, what do I mean by stable variegation? What I mean by stable variegation in the context of this video is a plant that will probably not need preserving in order to keep the variegation. In other words, it won't need to be cut in order to keep the variegation. It is highly likely that the variegation will just persist and you will not have to interfere with it. Not only that, but a lot of the plants on this list do have genetic variegation, meaning it is not a natural mutation caused in order to get this variegation. It's just part of the plant. The second thing I would like to mention is if I ever speak about the perceived value of a plant in this video, please note that these values may change and they may differ for you based on where you are in the world. For example, I'm recording this video in the UK in November during the middle of a pandemic. So if you happen to be watching this video 6 months to a year later, please keep in mind that the values I've listed in this video may be completely different to the current values for you and where you are. But I guess with all these crazy prices going on, it's kind of fun to look back at what the prices were, I guess. One last thing I would like to mention, the plants in this list are not ranked. So that means that a plant at number one is no better than a plant that is listed at number 10. And this is mainly due to the fact that this is purely personal taste. There are many, many, many other stable variegated plants outside of this video, but these are the ones I've selected today. If you want to see any more videos on this, then I'm quite happy to do them, so please leave a request in the comments. Without further ado, let's get started. So the first plant with stable variegation that I've selected for this list is the Monstera standaliana, also known as the philodendron cobra. Now, I don't actually know which one it is. As of recording this video, other people didn't seem to know which one it was either. It seems to go as both online. So you can find this plant by searching either philodendron cobra or Monstera standaliana. I'm probably going to call it standaliana for now, because that's what I think it is. But whatever this plant is, it is a really, really attractive plant. It is a climber and the leaves are a long, kind of narrow shape. The variegation on this plant is usually, but not always, white. And this more commonly has small flecks of white variegation, but it can also have patches of variegation as well. Now, I've had one of these. I've had one of these for a couple of years and I believe I have a slightly different one. Mine seems to be much more variegated than the others. I don't know if there's a difference between the one I have and a regular cobra standaliana. It does seem to look different, but I'm not really sure. If you don't have a ton of space, but you have vertical space, i.e. you can grow this thing upwards, it's a really nice structural plant with variegation that you don't really need to care about. It is subtle, but you don't need to worry about it. From what I've seen, they're also reasonably affordable as well, and you can often find them online. These plants are usually sold, from my experience, in the double digit range. Next on the list, we have the philodendron ring of fire, and this plant is named as such because it grows in a rosette-like formation, also known as a ring, and it has really interesting variegation. Now, this variegation can be pinky in toned, it can be slightly caramel in toned, and it can be white in tone. And the variegation will range from small, tiny little flecks or chunks to larger sectoral pieces. Not only that, but the plant has really interesting shaped leaves, so if you like the whole sawtooth thing, then this might be a plant to look for. Now, it's worth mentioning I have not included the philodendron caramel marble in this list, and that is mainly due to the fact that it doesn't seem anywhere near as stable as the philodendron ring of fire, in my experience and from speaking to other owners of this plant. This plant is way more prone to reversion, therefore I have not mentioned it on this list. So if you're wondering which one to go for, the ring of fire is probably a better option. It's also considerably cheaper right now. I can't remember the prices of Ring of Fire at the moment. They're not very available, but the price of a caramel marble will set you back almost into four figures. It's kind of crazy. I don't know when that happened. To add a little bit of pink into this list, the next plant on the list is Syngonium Pink Splash. Now, this plant follows suit of a lot of the plants on this list in the way that the variegation can range from the small specks or chunks to much larger sectoral patches of variegation. And in this case, it's pink. So if you're a pink lover and you're a little bit scared of going for something like a Philodendron Pink Princess, then things like the Syngonium Pink Splash are a really good option. Not only that, but Syngonium generally I find are extremely easy care. I've yet to find a difficult Syngonium. To add to that, they're really easy to propagate. So if you want to get something that looks a little bit different, but you want to practice your propagation, or maybe your plan is to buy the plant and sell pieces of it, or maybe you're propagating among friends, this is a really nice Syngonium, but also Syngonium in general, because Syngonium are just really good. I'm not sure as to the availability of this plant in the moment. Remember, I reside within the UK and EU, sort of, so my availability for me might differ than what it is for you. Next up, dipping into the family of Marantisii for a little while, this is the Tenanthe lebersiana. I think that's how you pronounce it. This plant has kind of square slash oval leaves that produce a creamy yellow variegation, and it's always in chunks. So if you like the vibe of a lot of the rarer variegated chunky looking plants, but you don't feel that you want to spend the money on them, maybe you're just into things like Calathea, Maranta, Tenanthe, then this is quite a nice plant to add to your collection. I think it would really give it some pop. As of recording this video, these plants are quite available within the EU. I'm pretty sure I could pick one up right now online if I looked. So if that's something you're looking for, give it a Google, because you might just find it. Continuing on with a slight theme of pink and a theme of Marantisii, this is the Stromanthe Sanguinea Triostar. And let me tell you, this is one of my personal favorites. And I really hope, if you've never seen this plant before, that you can really understand why. This is a showstopper. So the undersides of this plant, not to mention the amazing blade shapes of the leaves, the undersides of this plant are an absolute hot fuchsia pink, no exaggeration, bright, bright pink. To accompany that, the plant has naturally occurring variegation that happens in very large sweeping sectoral chunks along the leaf. There is a little bit of a bonus here as well. Because the undersides of the plant are such a hot pink color, the variegation that comes through on the leaf is a kind of white creamy color, but due to those really hot pink undersides, you do get a really nice blushed baby pink variegation all over the plant. So it is both a creamy white variegated plant, but it's also a really pink plant. So if you're looking for something like that, it's a really good one to go for. Not only that, but I've never had an issue personally in looking after this plant. I don't even give it filtered water. I really don't. I give this thing tap water and it seems fine, which we shouldn't be doing that. I'm not advocating doing that, but it seems fine. So. And this is one of these plants, similar to the last plant, actually, that you don't have to do anything to preserve the variegation. It is not going to revert on you. This is the plant. So if you find this plant and you buy this plant, what you see is what you get. The final member of the Marantisii family on this list is an extremely difficult plant. It's actually hailed as being the most difficult plant out of all of them that you could probably buy, and that is the Calathea White Fusion. Now, this is an absolutely stunning looking plant, but if you want to pick one of these up, you might want to speak to a few owners of the plant and just generally look up the care, because this plant is like Calathea on steroids. This plant is really hard to keep happy. You need insane humidity, you need the best water, and if you look at it wrong, it will go brown and crispy like a Dorito. So I don't want to put anybody off. I just want you to know that in terms of Calathea, it is known to be the hardest Calathea there is. That said, it's absolutely stunning, and the variegation does come through in like brilliant, brilliant white sectoral swirls. The leaf shape is really beautiful. It's not oval. I can't really describe the shape of it, so picture on the screen, but it's such a beautiful plant, but so hard to keep happy. Now, in my experience, these are incredibly difficult to find online, and I would imagine, taking a wild guess at it, that that is due to the fact that they are so difficult to look after. I imagine that even a lot of shops may struggle to look after this plant. So good luck finding one. I'm not sure how and widely available they are, and that's me speaking from the UK. So if you do happen to find one of these gorgeous plants, best of luck to you. So the next plant on my list is a little bit of a holy grail within its category. And there are two plants in this entry, but I'm really only going to talk about one of them because I feel like one of them has more chance of surviving than the other one, despite the fact that these plants look nigh on identical. And that is the Musa II, I think that's how you pronounce it, or the Musa Florida. Now, as I mentioned before, these plants look pretty much identical. It would take somebody into banana plants to really tell these apart, if I'm honest. For all intents and purposes, they are the same. The only real difference in these plants, I'm told, is the actual banana that they produce. One is slightly different from the other in taste. I have had conflicting opinions, I will say it real quick, on the II and the Florida on how easy they are to grow. The most popular opinion seems to be that the Florida is easier. So, I don't know, you'd have to do your research if you're looking for one of these, but they're not very easy to find. That's the only real issue. For me, I actually had two of these, but now I have one of these, and I've had one of these plants for 4 to 6 months, and it took a long time to really get going. So it is a very, 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 very sensitive plant, but if you get one, the variegation is really, you will see the picture now, it's really something else. It's absolutely stunning and it is stable. So if you do buy this, you don't need to worry about it going green. I've never heard any cases of them going green, so you should be pretty safe. Another unfortunate thing to note about these plants, other than the sensitivity, is the price. Now these plants have always been expensive. I would say they've always been around the low treble digit range, but due to the pandemic, that price has gone up and you can find these plants anywhere, I believe, between the low digit range, if you're very lucky, and the high 3-digit range. Personally, due to how sensitive this plant is and how difficult this plant is, either of them, to be honest, I probably wouldn't invest in one at this time during the pandemic because the risk is so high. If you really want one of these babies, I suggest you wait a little bit longer for the prices to come down, and they will. But it's gonna take some time, I think. I mean, you could buy one now if you want to, but that investment is so risky. So it's up to you. Do it if you like the pain. The next plant on my list is a plant that I'm guessing pretty much everyone that watches my channel should know about. It is a great plant. I'm a massive advocate for it. I think it's fantastic. And that is the Monstera Thai constellation. This is a plant that in terms of variegation, you should really have no fear investing in, because the variegation on this is similar to another plant on this list. I often compare it to it, but the plant has variegation ranging from a kind of constellation pattern, hence the name, so little flecks, little patches, to huge sectoral chunks. And you get what you get, because these Thai constellations are very chaotic in nature with their variegation. This plant, if you don't already know, is produced entirely from tissue culture in Thailand, hence the name Thai constellation. That's where the name actually comes from. This does mean, however, due to the current pandemic, these plants are either really available or not available. You will often find that they come out in waves, and you will see sellers come out with a few Thai constellations, then they will be sold, and then there is nothing. And then there is a wait, and then there is more, and then they're sold, and then there is nothing. The demand is really high at the moment, and pretty much everyone is having trouble keeping up to these labs producing these plants. The cool thing about a Thai constellation compared to a variegated Monstera is the fact that a Thai constellation is a large form Monstera, which means that you're going to get those really big, huge leaves with loads of splits and loads of leaves, and it'll be variegated. So if that's something that you're really looking forward to, then this one is great for that. They're pretty tough as well. I haven't really had any problems with Thais. I think all around they're pretty tough plants. Another quick note on availability for this plant, and this may just apply mainly to people in the US, but Costa Farms plan on rolling out the Thai constellation at some point in the future. Now, previously, they were supposed to be rolling out this plant in 2021, but no doubt the current situation has meant that this has actually been pushed back to 2022, and they have confirmed this on their Instagram. So if you're wanting to wait for Costa to bring these things out, that's totally fine, but you will now be waiting another year to get it. So your choices realistically are to find one at the current prices, or you can wait for Costa to roll these out, or another big box store chain to roll these out. I do think, however, that these big box stores are going to remain competitive somewhat with the prices. So I wouldn't expect to see a huge price decrease if you're wanting to wait to get one. But should you want to wait for this plant in 2022, that is absolutely your choice. I just wanted you to know that it had actually been pushed back, because I'm not sure that everybody knows this. The next plant with stable variegation on this list is an absolute favorite of mine as well, and that is the philodendron Jose Bono. Now, what I like to do is almost directly compare this plant with a Thai constellation, in that the variegation often looks the same. So the variegation is an off-white color, and like many plants on this list, it can seem to range between small chunks or flecks or speckles to larger sectoral chunks. Now, there is something to note about the variegation on these plants, and that is that when variegation comes through on the leaf straight away, depending on your light levels, you will see anything ranging from a pretty white color, an off-white, to a minty green color. Now, get those in better light and they will give you better variegated leaves, but you need to know that this variegation will fade down over time to a minty color. So they behave a little bit like a philodendron Florida ghost in that sense. They're still brilliant plants though, and the variegation is still very stable and very beautiful. Just understand that when you have a plant with loads of leaves, the newer leaves are going to be a lot more variegated than the old ones. But if you like the appearance of the plant once that the plant has faded down, so it is kind of like a green and then a minty color over the top, if you love that, then absolutely give this plant a go, because it's absolutely fantastic. This plant is a climber, so you can pop it on a pole and you can propagate this pretty well. I've never had any failed cuttings or propagations from this plant, so that's a good plus point as well. These plants are in pretty high demand at the minute and they're not readily available at all, so I can't really speak to the availability of this plant anywhere, to be quite honest. I know that the price when I last saw it was in the low treble digit range. I don't think you would ever be paying more than low treble digits in the current climate. Now, the last plant on my list, I don't know if anybody is expecting me to mention, but I must mention this on the list, and I must mention it directly after the previous plant, because there is often some confusion between the previous plant, the philodendron Jose Bono, and this plant. This plant here is the philodendron Ilmanii, and it is not in any way connected to the philodendron Jose Bono. They are completely different plants. There are a few differences between these plants, but I want you to note the price difference as well, because the philodendron Jose Bono, as I mentioned before, can usually reside in the low three-digit range. A philodendron Ilmanii will be in the low four-digit range. So the first number of the plant is likely to start with a two, and it's probably got four digits. As of recording this video, as of being where I live, that value may have changed by the time you watch this video, because I don't know when you're watching this video, so please do your research on that. These plants are not readily available at all. These are usually passed around between collectors. You can sometimes find a one-leaf cutting on a Facebook auction. That's actually how I got mine, but they're really, really hard to find. This is kind of like the Ablica situation a year ago, when there weren't that many around and they were starting to be auctioned on Facebook and they were starting to be passed around, whereas now they're kind of everywhere, actually. If you are in any doubt as to which plant you are looking at when you're trying to purchase this, please get a second opinion from somebody else that potentially owns one. Feel free to post it in a group to test to the validity of it, because I don't want anybody getting scammed. But a lot of the differences between these plants tend to come in when the leaf is a little bit more mature. So baby plants are much harder to tell apart with the Ilmanii and Jose. They can be told apart, it's just very difficult. By the time the plant reaches a little bit of a level of maturity, you will see the difference very clearly. A Jose Bono has a long, elongated kind of paddle shape, and an Ilmanii is way different. It has really long, pointy lobes, and the plant forms a kind of coffin shape. It's really, really beautiful. Moving away from the differences and availability, let's talk about the variegation. So the variegation on this plant is really something else. I don't own a plant that behaves the same as this one. I've made cuttings of this plant, and all the plant's cuttings are behaving slightly differently. But generally speaking, variegation on this plant can range from a kind of spray painted effect. So the whole plant looks almost frosted and sprayed on with an aerosol spray. So most of the leaf may be white and it will have a little green flecks in it. It's really, really interesting. If it's not that way inclined, because the leaves are quite chaotic and they seem to change, then you can get patches of variegation, but they're really odd shaped patches. Again, they're not like any of the other variegated plants on this list. I've done my best to include some photographs for you so you can see the kind of thing that I'm talking about, but it's really something else. It is a climber as well, so if you want to grow that upwards or if it matters to you at all, it is a climber the same as the previous plant, the same as a lot of plants on this list. As of recording this video, I have seen some cases of Eelmanni with very little variegation. Now, I do think this is down to the initial cutting of the plant just having low variegation. Every time I see a plant, it's good to go. I've never seen a plant that's struggling with variegation all the way up. You gotta remember, this is very difficult because this plant is just not owned by a ton of people, so it's kind of hard to compare notes because a lot of collectors on these plants don't necessarily broadcast the fact that they have this plant. So it's difficult to determine exactly how the variegation works. In my experience from making cuttings from leaves with low variegation, the next leaf has produced a ton of variegation. If you have conflicting information about this, please let me know below and I'm happy to pin a comment on it if what I'm saying right now is wrong. But to conclude, an incredibly, incredibly beautiful plant, especially when it gets going. As I mentioned before, it is in the four-digit range right now. I don't think anybody is selling these plants for less than at least $1,000, euro, anything at the moment. I do think they will drop to the high three-digit range, but I think it's going to be a long time before they do. I don't think we're anywhere near that level just yet. So if you want to invest in that, please find a reputable person. If you don't want to invest in that, then the weight for you might be quite significant. If you take, for example, what's happened with the Monstera Oblica, these plants are still very expensive and they haven't really come down yet. I imagine that the Philodendron Eelmanni will make a similar journey. So if that's anything to go off, I guess that's what we can expect. And that was the last plant. There you have it. There are 10 plants with stable variegation. Now, there are a lot of other plants, a lot more common plants, such as different varieties of variegated epipremnum, pothos, some philodendron, the philodendron Brazil, for example. There are a ton of plants that have stable variegation, but I tried to include things that are a little bit more unusual, just so they're not the things that you may or may not already have at home. I really hope you enjoyed this video. I hope it was somewhat informative, if not just entertaining. And if you'd like any more videos on essentially top 10 plants, I'm more than happy to do them. Please leave a request down below in the comments and I will be sure to take a look. That's it for this week's video, guys. If you liked it, please leave a like down below. It really helps. And if you like it even more and you'd like to see any more of my content, then please hit that subscribe button. Similarly, you can also follow me on Instagram at KayleeEllenOfficial. I post kind of everything there, to be honest. A lot of shop stuff, a lot of just random pictures of plants. I mean, what else would you expect on a plant Instagram? Thank you very much, guys. I will see you next week. Bye.